World leaders are grappling with how to fight back against extremist groups like Islamic State that are radicalizing young people. Here's a scenario that's raising fears in Western countries.
Fighters who travel to and from Syria and Iraq.
Naive, alienated Muslim youths by the thousands are traveling to Syria, being trained and indoctrinated by ISIS, and returning home, if they survive, as hardened terrorists. What can be done to counter that?
There are at least four schools of thought, all of which have their critics. One, work on root causes. A State Department spokeswoman recently said, insufficient schooling and job opportunities in the Arab world are pushing people to join extremist groups.
Whether it's lack of opportunity for jobs.
We're not going to be able to stop that in our lifetime.
Critics say there's no correlation between poverty and Islamist extremism, and some of the most notorious terrorists have been educated and far from poor. Two, humiliate ISIS on the battlefield. Take back territory the group has claimed, and their alert of foreign fighters will disappear. Here, the thorniest issues involve which countries are willing and able to send troops in to fight ISIS on the ground. Three, cracking down on would-be foreign fighters before they leave to join the battlefield. In the UK, the government is under scrutiny after three teenage Muslim girls slipped out of the country. This happened less than a week after the government adopted measures aimed at curbing travel to Syria. Critics there are calling for tougher enforcement procedures. French authorities say at least one of the Charlie Hebdo attackers received weapons training from an Al-Qaeda offshoot in Yemen. So in France, travel bans are becoming a key plank in government efforts to stem the flow of Western nationals to Syria and other conflict zones. The French government on Monday announcing it was barring six nationals from leaving the country, and the government is preparing travel bans for an additional 40 individuals.
I've often heard Western leaders describe Islam as a religion of peace. I wish more Muslim leaders would say that more often and mean it.
Australia's Prime Minister Tony Abbott is calling for new measures to crack down on Muslim extremists within his country. In downtown Sydney in December, a man claiming to represent Islamic State took several hostages in a cafe. The gunman was killed, and two of his hostages also died. The government is crafting laws to make it possible to revoke the citizenship of people with dual nationality if they travel abroad to join radical groups. The fourth approach? A theological battle against extremism. In Saudi Arabia, the head of Sunni Islam's most esteemed learning center is calling for sweeping changes in what is taught to young Muslims in schools and universities. In a speech to 700 Muslim clerics, Sheikh Ahmed Al-Tayeb said, terrorist organizations are using corrupt interpretations of the Quran and the life of the Prophet Muhammad to justify violent attacks on Muslims and non-Muslims alike. If moderate theologians are successful in destroying the underpinnings of ISIS's belief system, it would prove the pen really is mightier than the sword. That's the short answer.